When you work with data, you're probably used to rows and columns, structured data in a database or a spreadsheet. But what if I told you there's another layer, one that brings your data to life by adding where things happen, not just what happens? That's where spatial data comes in. At its core, spatial data is split into two fundamental types, vector and raster. These are the building blocks of everything from simple location points to complex geographic models. Let's start with vector data. If you've ever mapped out store locations, plotted addresses, or worked with geographic boundaries, you've already used it. Vector data represents discrete objects in the real world. A point is the simplest type, a single location with a latitude and longitude, such as a crime report, a bus stop, or a weather station. A line connects multiple points, roads, rivers, even airline flight paths, anything that represents movement or connection. And then we have polygons, shapes that define boundaries, countries, building footprints, even the zones used for real estate pricing or environmental protection. Each of these is defined by precise coordinates, making vector data great for things that have clear edges and positions. But now let's talk about raster data, which works completely differently. Instead of objects, raster data is built from grids of pixels, just like an image. Each pixel contains a value representing something about that specific location. Let's think about satellite images for a minute. Every pixel in that image carries information about the color, temperature, or land cover of the area that it covers on planet Earth. Elevation models work much the same way, where each pixel represents the height above sea level. In climate maps, they show temperature, precipitation, or even air pollution at a specific time and place, all stored in grid format. So raster data is perfect for representing continuous surfaces, things that don't have hard edges, but change gradually across space. So why does this matter? Whether you're tracking real estate prices, mapping climate change, or analyzing traffic flow, understanding vector and raster data is the key to making sense of spatial patterns. But here's the thing, spatial data doesn't stop there. There's a whole world beyond vector and raster that's shaping how industries use location data today. If you're coming from a data science or big data background, you're probably used to working with structured and unstructured data. And in the spatial world, there's an entire ecosystem beyond the basics, formats built for scale, precision, and advanced analytics. Let's start with 3D and LiDAR. Unlike traditional vector data, which represents objects in two dimensions, LiDAR captures the real world in full 3D. It's the backbone of self-driving car navigation, detailed city modeling, even augmented reality applications. Each point in a LiDAR dataset carries a precise height and reflectance values, creating a high-resolution map of buildings, terrain, and even vegetation. Then there's array-based climate data, which works on a completely different structure. Instead of simple grids or points, formats like NetCDF and HDF store massive multi-dimensional datasets using climate modeling, oceanographic research, and atmospheric science. These aren't just pictures of the Earth, they're time series datasets that track changes over months, days, even decades. And if you've ever struggled with handling large geospatial dataset, cloud-optimized formats are a game changer. COG, or cloud-optimized geotiff, lets you access raster data without downloading an entire file, perfect for satellite imagery analysis at scale. Geoparquet, on the other hand, brings vector data into the modern data stack, making it easy to store, query, and analyze massive spatial datasets alongside traditional tabular data. Understanding these formats isn't just useful, it's essential. Whether you're working with urban planning, climate science, or machine learning, knowing how to handle modern geospatial data will set you apart. Because today, spatial isn't just about maps, it's about high-performance computing, real-time analytics, and unlocking new insights from the world around us. But spatial data isn't just about the where. It's about how things relate to each other, and that's the real power of spatial thinking. If you've ever worked with databases, you're probably familiar with joins, combining data from different tables based on a shared key. In the spatial world, we do the same thing, but instead of matching an ID or a category, our key is location. Think about this. How many schools are within a mile of a park? Which customers live closest to a store? Where do high temperatures overlap with wildfire zones? Look, these aren't just interesting questions. They form the basis of spatial thinking. Let's take a simple example. A city planning department wants to assess flood risk for every building in the city. Instead of manually checking thousands of properties, we can run a spatial join, combining building footprints with flood zone data. Instantly, we get a new data set showing which buildings are inside flood-prone zones. Spatial relationships go beyond just proximity. Containment is a property inside a designated tax zone. Intersection, do two areas overlap, like a conservation zone and a new construction project? Nearest neighbor, what's the closest hospital to an accident site? Entire industries run on these relationships. Retail chains optimize store locations based on customer density. Insurance companies assess risk by analyzing past disasters. Ride-sharing apps match drivers and passengers in real time. And spatial thinking isn't just about looking at maps. It's about asking better questions and finding deeper insights. And once you start thinking spatially, you'll never look at data the same way again. Now, working with spatial data requires the right tools, and the good news is you don't need expensive software to get started. There's a powerful ecosystem of open source tools that can handle everything from basic mapping to large-scale geospatial processing. If you're looking for a desktop system, QGIS is the best place to start. It's fully featured, highly customizable, and free. Whether you're visualizing layers or performing spatial joins, or running even advanced geospatial processing, QGIS can handle it. For a spatial database, there's PostGIS, an extension of PostgreSQL, that brings powerful spatial capabilities to SQL. Need to find all the houses within a flood zone, query millions of points to find the nearest location, PostGIS makes it possible with simple SQL statements. Now, if you're a Python user, GeoPandas makes spatial data analysis as easy as working with pandas. Read shapefiles, perform spatial joins, and run geometry operations all within a familiar data frame structure. Now, if you need big data processing, there's Apache Sedona. It extends Apache Spark to handle massive spatial datasets, making it perfect for large-scale geospatial analytics in the cloud. Of course, open source isn't the only option. Many organizations rely on commercial tools, and some are deeply embedded in industry workflows. Esri's ArcGIS is the enterprise standard. It's a complete ecosystem for geospatial analysis, widely used in government, environmental research, and urban planning. For cloud-based analysis, Google Earth Engine is a powerhouse. It allows users to analyze massive satellite imagery datasets without worrying about infrastructure. And if you're working with business intelligence tools, Tableau, Apache Superset, and Power BI offer built-in spatial analytics and visualization, helping analysts incorporate maps directly into their dashboard. And on top of that, there's a bustling and growing modern geospatial data stack that is adding more and more tools with wide-ranging capabilities. But how do organizations actually use location data to create value? To do that, let's take a look at how one company places electrical vehicle charging stations across the United States. In 2024, Flow, one of America's largest EV charging networks, faced a major challenge. They weren't just trying to install more chargers, they needed to put them in exactly the right location, but their data wasn't up to task. Their existing data was riddled with outdated and misplaced points of interest. Some charging locations had closed years ago, yet were still in their system, and worst of all, their data was only updated once a year, making it impossible to keep up with the rapidly growing EV market. Then came a turning point. Flow switched to Dataplore, a global location data provider that produces up-to-date global points of interest data. And let's just say the difference was immediate. Their machine learning models became far more accurate, allowing them to predict where charger demand would surge before it even happened. The result? Faster expansion, better charger placements, and a network optimized for real-world demand. Drivers benefited too. Chargers were now appearing in the most convenient, high-traffic areas, reducing wait times and improving accessibility. Look, we're in the middle of a spatial revolution, and most businesses and people don't even realize it. Businesses are using location intelligence to outmaneuver competitors. Cities are using spatial data to optimize infrastructure. Scientists are tracking climate change, disease outbreaks, and global trends with geospatial analytics. Yet, in most industries, spatial data is still an afterthought. If you're a data professional and you're not thinking about location, you're missing out on an entire dimension of insight. The where in your data is just as important as the what, and it's time to start using it. So if you want to dive deeper into the world of spatial analysis, modern GIS tools, and real-world applications, follow along, because the future of data isn't just big, it's spatial.